Hello and welcome to the program. I am Deji Badimasi. It's been a rather tense week for both the federal and Niger state governments after armed gunmen stormed the Government Science College, Kagara, seizing several students, staff, and some members of their families. This comes less than 3 months after a similar incident in Katsina State, where over 300 boys of the Government Science Secondary School in Kankara were abducted before they were finally released days after their kidnap. It does appear now that schools have become easy targets for bandits. The latest attack in Niger has actually forced the governor, Abubakar Bello, to order the immediate closure of all boarding schools in vulnerable areas. While the bandits are fomenting trouble in different parts of the northwest and northeast, some persons, including some northern lawmakers, have argued that one way out of the crisis is to dialogue with the bandits instead of waging a war against them. Some people have also argued that licensing guns for all citizens may address some of these problems. So what exactly will work in the country to address the worsening security situation? All right, I'm now being joined on the program by Dr. Kabir Adamu, who is the founder and CEO of Beacon Consulting, which is a security consulting firm operating out of Nigeria and in some Sahelian countries. Doc, thank you very much for joining us on the program. It's just been a couple of weeks ago, sometime in December, that we got you on the program and we were talking about the Kankara kidnapping now that happened in Katsina State. And now we are talking about, you know, just a few weeks down the line, we have a similar situation, this time in Niger State. And we're talking about an area known as Kagara. There seem to be some kind of similarity in the names there. But what do you make of this? Are you surprised that we're having to deal with this with a similar situation again, just few weeks after?
Thank you, Mr. Deji. Frankly, the emotions that are running through me are ones of disappointment, of anger, and helplessness. We know we talked about this. We recommended certain solutions, and I am of the opinion that if those measures or solutions had been taken or implemented, then we will not be here. The location, Kagara, where this incident happened, is in Rafi local government.
Another remote area.
Yes, and there are three local governments in Niger State that have been hotspots for banditry activities. So it is inconceivable that the authorities in that state allowed schools to remain open, knowing very well that those schools are vulnerable.
Especially schools in those local government areas?
Exactly, the three local governments, Shiroro, Rafi, and Munya local governments. In fact, you can extend it to the eight local governments in Niger East Senatorial District. Now, the fact that the physical security in those schools were not adequate and that these attackers could come in and penetrate the school and carry out their activities is really, really embarrassing and inconceivable. Despite the several warnings, the several media coverage, and the vulnerability assessment that have been provided by different security practitioners, both public and private.
But let's face it, it is not practically speaking, it's not possible to have security agents in all of the schools in these places. It's just absolutely impossible. What could have been done differently?
So this Safe School Initiative, which by the way, Nigeria has endorsed, were a signatory to that Safe School Initiative after the World Economic Forum in 2014. We signed up to that initiative and we gathered money. There was a pool. I can't remember the exact figure for that pool, but Gordon Brown actually helped us in terms of popularizing and helping gain support for the funding for that initiative. It has three components. One component is the physical security around the school. So fence, the systems that would operate the physical security, as well as things like CCTV, lighting and all that. The second component is the residents inside the school. So the teachers, the pupils, the non-academic staff, the contractors and other visitors that will come to the school. Now, all of these levels will be trained on security. They would know indicators of danger, safety and security issues, and how to respond once they see those indicators. Then the last component is the community where the school is located. The community too will be trained to take note of indicators and what to do when they see those indicators. So if we had implemented the Safe School Initiative, we wouldn't need the type of security presence that you are mentioning. What we would require is adequate response by the security operators. In other words, when the community notices the indicators, like in the instance of Kagara, we are told that the community actually noticed some happenings before the incident occurred. So if they had been trained and they had been given the equipment that is required under the Safe School Initiative, they would have contacted the security agencies. And now it is mandatory for the security agencies to now respond, because it's not just enough to notify them, they have to respond. And when they respond, they would need to protect whatever community informs them. So that's the Safe School Initiative. And if we implement it, I bet you it will help reduce it. This type of occurrences.
Let's talk about this, because you alluded to it a bit, the issue of intelligence. Yes, it is true, it is not possible to have security agents in all of these places. And then you look at the way these bandits operate. They essentially target remote communities, remote schools. I mean, Kankara, remote area. Response time, of course, would naturally be delayed. It would take some time before security agents would get there. These are places that, you know, not so easy to access as well. And that's what we have seen in Kagara. Why has intelligence actually failed us? Because, as you've said, if the people actually had some kind of warning, they got that information that something like this was going to happen, why didn't they pass the information on to the security agencies?
Intelligence is one of the most misused words in Nigeria, unfortunately. We use information most times to describe intelligence. Intelligence is not a pedestrian word. It's a word that is functional. You will often hear the word actionable intelligence, and that means intelligence you can work on. Now, yes, intelligence is also a function of the imperative of the collector. So in this instance, since it is public intelligence, what is the imperative of the collecting agency, which is usually guided by the government? So I will expect the kind of intelligence that would identify the forest where these bandits are staying, that would identify the leadership of the bandits, that would identify the types of weapons they are using, that would identify where they're getting those weapons, that would identify their funding. Then, more importantly, the supply channel for all of these things that I mentioned. I'm aware, based on my consultancy, that there are about four levels to their operations. You have the bandits themselves. Then you have their collaborators within the society. Then you have those that have, for one reason or the other, joined the network because they are benefiting from it. So as an example, they are supplying prostitutes to them, they are supplying food to them, or they are supplying drugs to them. So indirectly also benefiting from that in the industry. And then lastly, you have those who, because they are not being protected by the state authorities, they are keeping quiet or they are turning the other cheek. Now, that's the kind of intelligence I expect to be harvested. Now, the next question is, when you harvest this intelligence, what are you going to do with the intelligence? In this instance, I would expect the state to use that intelligence to take out, especially the leadership, use tactical teams, deploy those tactical teams to the forest, take out the leadership of this movement, and then if you want to start negotiating on engagement with those that are left behind, you can do that. But intelligence should be actionable and allow you to take them out in a manner that would ensure you decapitate the bandit self, so that at least you would have reduced this kind of boldness that we're seeing being displayed at the moment. Now, the fact that we're not doing that tells me clearly there is a failure of intelligence.
And obviously, if this is allowed to continue, we can clearly see that, you know, one attack inspires another attack. We had Chibok, nothing happened. That served as an inspiration for other attacks, similar attacks that we have seen. Kankara, up till date, we've not heard of any arrest at all or prosecution. And that, of course, has emboldened this present bandits now who attacked Kagara. And if nothing happens in this case, if we do not deal with it differently, obviously we're still going to have more attacks of this nature, right?
Exactly. So that leads us to the point around accountability. When the ball is dropped like this, and innocent pupils who have been handed over to a school authority that is supposed to be their custodian, I will use the word in the development cycle called safeguarding. Pupils, students, are to be in a safeguard arrangement where the school authority is their custodians. Now, that school authority, for reasons that need to be investigated, has allowed kidnappers to come and kidnap them. Now, I'm not in any way putting the responsibility on the principal, but he also has some level of responsibility, because I should be able to look at whoever is my line manager, if it's the commissioner of education in that state, to tell her that, madam, this school that I have pupils in is vulnerable and you need to do X, Y, Z. If you don't do it, this is my letter advising you to do it. If something goes wrong, I will point to the fact that I've written to you. And if the commissioner has also written to whoever she needs to write to, the SGF or the governor, and that has not been done, then those are channels and investigations that should be conducted. And persons who fail to carry out their responsibilities should now be held accountable. Now, I'm assuming that school is a state-run school.
Yes.
If it's a federal school, that is the same manner. Did the principal write to the minister through whoever his line manager is? And did the minister, for instance, write to the Inspector General of Police or whoever has responsibility for protecting schools? That kind of investigation need to be conducted so that whoever is responsible and didn't take the right action should be held accountable. There is a police division in Kankara. Did the commissioner, the DPO in that police division, was he informed that some irregularities have been observed by the residents of Kankara and he failed to take action? The SSS personnel that is deployed to Kagara. Kankara, did he write a report? And when that report was received by the state command, did the state command take action? If they did, who was supposed to take action to ensure that those students were not kidnapped? So that's the kind of investigation that
And you know, one other thing, I hate to say this, but the truth is that if this had not happened, we probably would not have known of the state of that school. I believe you have seen the videos and pictures of that school. That is that shouldn't be a school at all. It's completely collapsed, no fence, nothing. So, you know, the students were just sitting down there and waiting to just get picked, and that's exactly what happens. And it's actually a shame, a big shame, that we would have a school of this nature, a science school at that. And that's one part of this whole thing that we're actually not talking about. Because if schools are not well built and schools are not well protected, I'm talking in terms of even infrastructure, then the students there will just be like a sitting duck waiting to just get kidnapped. And I believe there are quite a number of schools like this scattered across Niger State.
Not just Niger State, across the country. I'll speak about the north, where I have extensive operations, and I can tell you that there's a huge number of schools that are either in this condition or even more deplorable than the picture you are showing at the moment. I agree with you totally. The circumstances in the school makes these students, you know, sitting ducks, really. I'm not going to mention the school, but even in the Federal Capital Territory, in the outlying areas of the Federal Capital Territory, I recently went to a school And as a professional, the first thing that occurred to me is this school is next to a mountainous area. And at the, in the front, there is a perimeter fence. But behind it, there is no perimeter fence. And what came to my mind is, look, this is it's just a matter of time before an abduction incident happens here. And I did raise that to the non-academic personnel that was together with me. I said, look, take this up to your principal. The principal needs to highlight this. Otherwise, this is another abduction incident waiting to happen. So bottom line, what I'm saying is there are several schools, not just across the states, even in the federal capital territory, that are in this type of circumstances. And the Safe School Initiative is talks about that. I mentioned physical security.
Yes.
So when you are doing the audit, these are the things you should look out for. And of course, we should make recommendation. And my worry is that the funding that should go into ensuring that we don't have this type of schools is there. We some of the expenses that we see across the country, frankly, if they are channeled into this area, perhaps we will not even have schools like this. In the field where I operate, there is this infamous vote called security vote. That security vote, believe me, if you channel it into areas like this, would be useful, because at the end of the day, you are going to produce students that are fit for the societies that we desire. And that means the pool of unemployed persons that we currently have who are unskilled would reduce. And the moment they are reduced, then the tendency for non-state actors to recruit them to become their foot soldiers would also reduce. So investing in education is actually investing in security.
Let me quickly ask you this before I let you go. We saw senators from, well, some lawmakers now from the north. We saw them address a press conference the other day, asking that the country, the government specifically, the federal government adopts the amnesty approach in dealing with the banditry we're seeing across the north of the country, citing the Zamfara case as an example. The Zamfara state governor, of course, as you know, has been quite vocal about it. As a matter of fact, he met with President Buhari and also propagated put forward that idea now. Do you think amnesty for these bandits would solve the problem?
So amnesty is always an option in conflict situation. But what you want to do is not to incentivize the weaponization of conflicts. There are different conflicts occurring. Once there are people together, conflict would occur. But you don't want to incentivize the weaponization of conflict. What am I trying to say? You don't want a situation where every conflict actor thinks that the only way you get government attention is if he picks up a weapon. And so when you engage, you want to engage from the standpoint of professionalism. There are strategies that are out there, and the most recommended one, because frankly we're dealing with an armed conflict. In fact, the kind of weapons in the hands of these bandits are military-grade weapons.
Yes.
So if you are going to engage them, you should do what the UN is recommending, and that is the disarmament, demobilization, and rehabilitation program. It has different stages and different concepts. Military experts as well as diplomats would tell you that for every DDR program, the disarmament, demobilization, and rehabilitation program, you have to do it in a manner that you don't incentivize conflict. Unfortunately, the method that the Zamfara state government, as well as the Katsina state government and other state governments have pursued, is not complying with these recommendations by the UN. And so the risk of the incentivization for weaponization of conflict in Nigeria is very, very high. It happened in the Niger Delta. It's now happening in the Northwest. So what are we trying to tell other non-state actors? Well, it means the more you terrorize the country, the more weapons you use, the more likely that you are going to be listened to. So my recommendation to the senators, the distinguished senators from Zamfara State who made that recommendation, is that they should advise the state government to engage experts who understand the principles of engagement, diplomatic engagement.
And not just keep throwing money at the problem, just giving these guys money.
Exactly. The more you give money, the more weapons they will buy. Even if they turn in weapons like you show us on TV, it doesn't mean they've turned in all the weapons. They've given you some, they've kept some. So at the level
and
of
I should say we have seen that in the Niger Delta.
Exactly. And there is also a responsibility for the federal government. I would recommend that the federal government provide a framework for this engagement. We shouldn't leave that engagement at the whims and caprices of state government. States. The consequences is too critical for us to leave it to the state government. So the federal government should come up with a framework that outlines the basics for engagement. In other words, ensure that when they are doing the engagement, the incentivization for weaponization of conflict in Nigeria is not encouraged. And more importantly, that instrument for punishing offenders is introduced in that engagement. You cannot kill a 17 or 18-year-old boy, shoot him with three bullets, a helpless boy in school, and then we offer you amnesty. No, I don't want to be in such a country that would do that.
Dr. Kabir Adamu, founder and CEO of Beacon Consulting, a security consulting firm based in Nigeria here. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you for talking to us.
Thank you for having me.
All right, we'll take a short break and we'll be right back.
Opinions are free. Facts are sacred. But truth is universal.
How, in practical terms, can we, for instance, de-escalate the tension?
President must see himself as the president of the Federal Republic.
We know where the enemy is. Three places. The Lake Chad Basin, the border area between Nigeria and Cameroon, and then the Sambisa Forest.
On Digi360, we give you a complete dose of everything. Opinion, facts, and undiluted truth.
I hardly believe what politicians have said in this part of the world.
The new Nigeria is possible. A future is possible.
We delve into the issues. Dissect it so that you can understand it. Use it to take action.
I don't think there's any need for any governor to look for grant for ranching.
Digi360, dissecting the issues.